Thank you very much for this session, and thank you for having us. I'm going to present a little bit more of a critical paper, and I have to say I'm very happy and appreciative of all the presentations we had so far. They truly were excellent, and they showcase this huge diversity and breadth in the study of archaeology and video games. That being said, I'm going to talk about politics, I'm going to talk about play, past, and about the field currently known as archaeogaming, video games and archaeology. Starting with politics and starting with archaeology, the archaeology component of this, it is sort of known that the roots of our discipline are generally colonial and mostly Western rich people having fun. So they would go somewhere as diplomats, as ambassadors, and they would collect all sorts of curiosities, and they would bring them back home to exhibit them in their mansions or eventually in various type of museums. But they were deeply tied with being rich, with being colonial, and, well, with just having fun, with collecting things for your own appreciation. So much so that even back then there was a discourse countering this, like, why do we need all these old stones? You go there in Greece, you bring back all these stones, you just, why are you doing this? We have perfectly good stones in our backyard. Of course, following the developments in archaeology and archaeology becoming a scientific field in itself, it developed its own theory, it developed its own methodology, and also following the developments of post-processual archaeology, we've seen this political aspect that is so apparent to us from the previous slide, all the problematics of the colonial roots of our history, is now actually central. We discuss it a lot, we talk about the political aspect of archaeology, gender issues, discussing difficult terms, and we do recognize that the past and the interpretations of the past are themselves deeply political. We're still kind of having fun with archaeology, but definitely not the kind of fun that they used to have, because now we take this seriously, right? So we can see that past is indeed deeply political. Nowadays we have another way of having fun, and that is games. Actually, fun, one of the most, or maybe one of the best examples of game design and game research is the MDA model, where to study or to design a game, you're moving from creating the rules to creating the system to eventually having fun. Fun is this central concept that you cannot do without. You can't have a game without having fun. That's something people already addressed in this session. Actually, the Ubisoft VP said games need to be fun before anything else. So games need to be fun. They very much need to be fun. Then in the beginning of the previous slide, it said apolitical fun. Now, this is something that has already been addressed in this session, but I want to give a few more examples. In the Civilization series, one of the most well-known grand strategy game series, has sold tens of millions of copies worldwide among its different iterations. And following one of the quotes of Sid Meier, the creator of this series, one of our fundamental goals of creating civilization was not to project our own philosophy or politics onto things. Laying out somebody else's political philosophy is not fun for the player. So what Sid Meier tells us is what is not fun is when you understand that the game is political, when you understand the politics of the game. What makes it fun is that you can do whatever you want. Of course, if one looks closely to the Civilization series, by definition, see being a forex game, we explore, expand, exploit and exterminate, but also the histories that are created within civilization, which are teleological, euphemistic, very Western focused, rationalistic, and in the end, extremely political. So, contrary to what Sid Meier says, civilization is a very political game, whether he likes it or not. And a lot of times people find it fun exactly because it has this type of politics in it, because it's what is familiar to a Western audience. Another example of this is the recent game Kingdom Come Deliverance, which was pitched as a realistic single-player RPG set in the medieval Europe, open-world sandbox with period-accurate melee combat, dungeons, and no dragons, because dragons are not real, of course. There was a huge controversy surrounding this game, because on one hand, it has a lot of historical accuracy, and if you're an expert of the period, you will be able to understand this, but it was also very accurately racist. One of the big omissions that people pointed out was that there were no people of color in the game. The developer of the game said, "Would you please explain to me what's racist about telling the truth? There were no black people in medieval Bohemia, period." And then he makes a meme out of this, that this is how it would look if they would include people of color in the game. Now, besides the explicit racism of these statements, it is also known and historically researched that there were, in fact, people of color in medieval Bohemia. And another example of politics into games that try to avoid by saying, oh, actually it's not political, is an example that has already been mentioned, concept of authenticity in Battlefield, where you get to play all sorts of things, and that the developers, and there was this huge controversy about having women in World War I, we already talked about this, but then the developers themselves would said, well, we don't care, we actually care more if it's fun rather than authentic, and whether having women on the battlefield is more fun than authentic maybe, so be it. This became a really huge thing in, if you were in forums during the period and in Reddit, there were really huge bans across the board for people to, people were not allowed to talk about historical accuracy because there was this Gamergate feeling going about. People didn't want women in their games because they thought, oh, this is not historically accurate, but they were not concerned about all these other not so historical aspects like grappling hooks in your mechanical arm. So, to sum this up, much like in archaeology and in games nowadays, the concept of the past is for having fun. They used to collect objects for having fun, and now we find it fun to play with it. And the idea back then, also now with the games, is that fun should be rid of politics, because politics are not fun. The fact of the matter is that both past and past play is not free of politics. And this is something that the field of archaeogaming has as a focal point in many ways. So that moves me to the role of archaeogaming. If you're not familiar with the term, archaeogaming as a field is a rather bottom-up grassroots initiative. It very much started from the blogosphere and from Twitter. And it was mostly done by students, by bachelor students to PhD students. It was definitely not done by the professors, by the big institutions. It was situated very much at the fringes. Now, core to archaeogaming, both because it was at the fringes, but also because of the type of crowd that was engaging with it, was politics. So, the field of archaeogaming recognized the importance of politics in games and has studied this extensively, from ethics to gender issues to just straight up political issues. But still, nonetheless, and even though in some cases these things have been in academic outlets, it's still not widely recognized within the archaeological field. It still exists very much at the fringes
of academia. And in many ways, that begs the question of what exactly are we doing? Is archaeogaming a fun pastime? It's very important to note that exactly because it was it originated within this blog sphere and Twitter sphere and from students, it was very much voluntarily driven. A lot of people who were doing this were not doing this professionally, they were doing this for free. Now, maybe they initially did because they had fun, but no matter what, they were doing this for free. And in many cases, it's still happening. We're very much streaming almost every week with Angus, but we're always doing it at Angus's office with the door closed, because we can't really justify to our colleagues, hey, we're playing 2 hours of this game and it's actually serious research. And I'm pretty sure that this is the same for many of you. It's very hard to justify to your colleagues that you're actually doing this. And even if nowadays we have archaeogaming conferences or sessions like this very session, oftentimes it's just a quirk archaeogaming session. Some people will go there just because they think it's fun or funny or weird, but they don't necessarily engage with it. And if we move further on, we should look at, all right, this thing has been going on for some time now, but how can we see our impact on this? What has happened so far? Because of course, there are developments. It's not like we started in the blogosphere and this ended there. When it comes to game design, we see that smaller indie developers have started engaging with the archaeogaming ground, either as consultancy or presenting on set conferences, but the big AAA developers still don't really want nothing to do with archaeogaming. And even though there are all these sessions, like the one 3 years ago in the EAA, a very recent review of the archaeogaming book by Andrew Reinhardt reads games like No Man's Sky received mostly negative reviews after launch because the developer promised too much and fans were expecting too much. Also, in Access, games frequently receive reviews stating the game has great potential, but both of these apply to archaeogaming. And I think this is quite an insightful quote, even though it's quite critical. We should consider it as to what is archaeogaming doing. Are we indeed in this early access phase? And when it comes to the public, an example is our streams with Angus. This value player subscribe Odyssey, our biggest hit, 508 viewers on YouTube. But for the most part, this is what's going on. And this is true for our streams and for several other people who are attempting to stream likewise. So the impact in the end is not that high. In fact, even in Twitter, where it's supposed to be a core platform for this field, the engagement levels are really low. Only a handful of people, when they are hashtagging archaeogaming, have some meaningful impact, but by and large, we don't see this hashtag being consistently high. So what are we to do? We do recognize that play and past are both political. And it is very important that we maintain this message of inclusivity and diversity and openness that is fundamental to the study of video games and archaeology. But what we should also strive towards is, while maintaining this openness, we need to make it somewhat sustainable. Because it's nice that we can travel to these conferences if we have the means. It's nice that some people can publish, but this doesn't make the field itself sustainable. And by sustainable, it doesn't need to be bought necessarily. It still needs to be open, it still needs to be accessible, but we have to be able to keep doing this somewhat. And in a very freeware model, this is going to be hard. So how to climb that hill
and how to engage the public and to the other academics. I think that archaeogaming has the power to make change. And if you see the quality of research and the type of research that takes place within archaeogaming, this is very much apparent. However, we should not limit to having fun just to ourselves. Oftentimes you'll see similar people, just like on Twitter, we need to grow ever more diverse and ever more open. We should actually take this fun that's core to archaeogaming, like it was in archaeology, and put it at the center rather than keeping it on the fringes. It's going to be a power struggle because it is so hard to justify doing this, but it also can be dangerously fun. So, to corroborate this, first of all, we already announced our Interactive Bus Conference 3. Some of you have already been there or have seen our streams, or if not, it's a good it's a good time to look it up. It's going to happen between 4th and the 6th of November 2020. We'll be announcing call for papers soon. But, like many other examples of archaeogaming, this, the Interactive Bus Conference, is something that we strive to make sustainable. And even though Value for now has the means to make this happen, in a couple of years or a few years down the line, maybe this won't be the case. So we would like your input as well on how to keep this conference free and open so everybody can come and everybody can watch it on stream, while making it sustainable. So this is very much a question for you. And to conclude, we would also like to start thinking of ways to make this sustainable. Maybe an idea would be to create an association for playful pasts, also known as TAP. If you go to playfulpasts.com, you can already see the domain existing with a form. But what we think is that there might be potential in creating a broader association from people from all over the world, not just Value, where people would strive towards making this field sustainable. So, in the end, we can see the glass half full, but maybe we just tap water. Thank you very much.